Creating an enabling environment for micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises require money, markets, and mentorship. In a bid to empower MSMEs further, the ASEAN Business Advisory Council is launching tomorrow, Friday, the ASEAN Mentorship for Entrepreneurs Network. Joining me now for more is Teresita Sy-Coson, the Vice Chair of SM Investments Corporation Philippines. She is also a member of the ASEAN Business Advisory Council Philippines. Good to have you back, Tessie. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Coming out of a very business schedule, you have been involved with the ABAC in the Mentorship Network. How did it come to be? How did the idea become something that the region could very well become part of?
The ASEAN Business Advisory Council is a go-between the government of the different states here in ASEAN, and also between the private to government. So it is an institutions where we coordinate in many areas that involves businesses.
So it's a collaboration between private and public, really a multi-sectoral effort.
Multi-sectoral.
And that includes conglomerates like yourself.
Yes.
How do you get into the picture here? How do you become helpful to enable the MSMEs to grow beyond our own borders?
We look in, our main task is the connectivity, be it borders and logistics, the regulations that will make ASEAN as one community this community has about 600 million people, so it is a bigger populations than just Philippines alone.
Yeah, when you mentioned regulations, it kind of raised like a red flag, because regulations mean a lot of restrictions and harmonization.
It will always be there.
And that's like 600, 650 million customers out there, but you can't get there because there's no harmonization of rules. Where do we start?
I think we have the government have the governments of the different ASEAN states have already harmonized certain tariffs. But right now, what they are discussing are the non-tariff. There are also the innovation, the digital space. So there are a lot of things which is constantly evolving, and which we have to constantly look into how to connect. Private sectors are doing their own task of coordinating on this. And so they're also asking the government to support whichever directions that the business of the different nations will be going will be geared towards.
On the issue of the non-tariff barriers, the NTBs, rules of origin, in what way can a conglomerate help an MSME go with the rules of origin, which means 40% local content? It is so difficult for a small entrepreneur to be able to tell what is local and what is imported in the content that they're exporting.
It's going to take a lot of work and a lot of years, the way I see it. You know, we have the bureaucratic activities in the government. I'm talking about government in general. And also there are business interests and sovereign interests. So it's going to take a while. We're not stopping at that. We're still going to go further and try to see how we can inch toward it.
How do you inch towards it? Because I'm thinking of, you know, okay, let's say they get the local content in place. There's the customs procedure.
Yeah.
My goodness, the paperwork. A small entrepreneur can't even get past the huge paperwork that has to be done to have a shipment, you know, brought through the Asian region.
This is what we discussed this morning, and our suggestion is to have a champion, for example, for this logistic, and who can put all of the logistic companies of the different nations in ASEAN, and see how we can, because of the needs of the business motivations and the commercial reasons for going into it, I think then they could ask the respective government to support what they think a logistic business needs. And also, and with that, then we can also look into how we can all interact with each other. With that, maybe we can make the government, our respective government, understand what are needed in this business, in this connectivity.
So who's going to champion logistics? I know that you've entered that that business about a month ago, March 31st, when you bought a minority stake in Togo.
Well, that is part of, we like to join the group. We're still putting the groups together. We're a very small player in this area, but we will look into how to put everybody together that is in this logistic. And perhaps with that, that can accelerate the non-tariff restrictions, hopefully by really explaining to respective governments.
Because it's all about bringing down the cost of shipping a product or a service across borders. Apart from that, there is also the issue of e-commerce. You made a mention of digitization, and I know that you're very much involved in Lazada. I just spoke with the boss of Lazada Philippines, and he said that the partnership between SMIC and Lazada Philippines is doing really well. But how well? Give us some statistics,
share. We have good working relationship, and our business have grown tenfold from the time that we started.
It was just about a year ago, tenfold.
Yes,
wow.
Yes. And I think that there's a lot of potentials in that business.
Why is that? Well, why is there a potential? Is it because of the lack of regulations or a lot of people having a smartphone or a laptop to actually create a transaction and make one?
No, it's just that some people would like to, people like to shop in different ways. Some online because they don't want to go to the store. Some likes to go to the store because it is more, it's a therapy. Some people would just like to do it on phone or text or whatever. So it's giving the customer different options to shop. And that is what we like to do in the future.
It makes me think about the mall culture that your dad senior had created many, many years ago when the business was just starting, the family business was just starting as a shoe store. How does it change all that? I mean, yes, we like retail therapy, but to what extent might it actually phase out the malls because we've got more access and you know, maybe when logistics gets better, it'll be better to get your shipment by the door in your home rather than go to the store.
Some people would like to order them from the comfort of their living room, but some of them would still like to go to the mall and socialize and interact with the other shoppers. We are going to cater to different ways of shopping. So for us, whatever the customer wants, we'll be there for them.
So what is going to be the mix of your growth businesses going forward? Mr. Dibuncha said yesterday that he was focusing more on logistics as one of the growth areas for SMIC.
Yes.
How does logistics come into play with e-commerce? How does it all work together to create that bundle for the customer?
One of the most expensive OPEX of e-commerce is logistics. And we had 1 year of experience, and we thought that maybe we should go into the logistic to really see how we can reduce the cost of the logistic.
Reason why you got into To-Go. That was a surprise. I was just speaking with Mr. Tagut about a month before you made the transaction. It was a minority purchase. How did it happen?
It was just a surprise twist when one of the funds wanted to get out of their investment fast, and we were there.
And are you intending to take on a bigger stake in the
Not really. Our challenge is to see how we can reduce the cost of logistics by having more volume. So it's still very new at this stage. So we will see.
Yeah, when you say volumes, can you actually quantify that? I mean, a lot of the people who have smartphones don't actually do transactions. We do have a lot of smartphone owners, but it still has to get to a certain base or, you know, a certain critical mass, if you will.
Yeah, yeah. No. Our logistic is not only for the e-commerce. It's also for other B2B. We're looking into e-commerce part of the logistic or transport or warehousing is for e-commerce, but that's not a big part at this point. In the Philippines, we still like to go to the mall, touch the item, be part of the activity. So maybe give it a few more years before e-commerce will become a very will become an important part of the shopping environment.
Yeah, speaking of that mall culture, Henry Jr., your brother, got interviewed by chance. And he did make a mention that, yes, we're ready to go to the ASEAN. Bring the malls of SM to the ASEAN. It's going to happen next year. Studies have been made. We're going to go for it.
Yes.
How soon and where are you going to start?
We are studying at this point. We are not, because, you know, to go into a lifestyle mall, we really have to know the market. And of course, right now the market has changed because of the digital, which means it's you don't really have to be there physically. So we're studying all of this different aspect before we make the move.
What are you finding so far in the ASEAN region? Is it homogenous or heterogeneous? Because in the lifestyle mall that you've created in Xiamen, it really worked out that you introduced the mall there as a lifestyle mall, catering to aspirations, brand, store. This is the kind of things that people want to aspire for, and it worked out. Can it work in the ASEAN setting?
I think it can still work in many Chinese area in China. I mean, I'm talking about the provincials area. In the ASEAN, perhaps in some countries, but not, I mean, we have to be selective.
You mean with Chinese communities within the ASEAN, presumably maybe Malaysia, Singapore?
No. I'm talking about China, Chinese China, you know. And I think there is an emergence of people into the middle market. So with that constant emergence into the middle market, there is a constant increase in shopping, in purchasing power. And I think lifestyle mall will be very successful there. We have a few successful ones. Some may be costing a loan, but more a majority of them are quite successful.
So where in the ASEAN would a lifestyle mall concept fit in?
I guess at this time it's still in the drawing board, so I won't be able to say which particular country.
No worries. Maybe in the next interview. But you know, in the banking industry, I caught one of your interviews you did about 3 years ago, and you did say that, you know, the ASEAN economic integration was still a new concept. We're still getting into the integration itself in 2015. And your key message is to the ASEAN, invest in the Philippines. 3 years on, do you think you would rather have a different message, considering the competition, the regulations, the challenges?
Well, the ASEAN right now has become a sweet spot in the global arena. And Philippines is also one of the best sweet spot in the ASEAN area. At this point, I would say we should still invest in the Philippines.
Still.
Look at our company. We have grown from 3 years ago. So if that is one way to show that there is opportunity in the Philippines. So I guess at this point, the only thing I have to emphasize ASEAN is because there are 600 million consumer compared to 100 million here in the Philippines. So if a company wants to expand, this is the best area to expand.
But sweet spot for who? I mean, a lot of competition has come in. Like, take, for instance, the banking industry. Too many foreign banks have just come in over the past 3 years. A lot of competition for the likes of BDO. Do you think that they moved in too fast, that the local Philippine lenders were not ready?
In a way, the regulations it was done too fast. But, you know, the market, it's market-driven. So somehow it will become borderless in the future. So digital banking can go to many other countries. But getting a license, it's easy for them to come in and get the license, but it's not very easy for us to get license abroad.
That's true, because you wanted a qualified ASEAN banking license, and you
were, and it's taking a lot of time, and so we have to redo our applications. So it will take quite a while.
Oh, well, why is that? Well, what makes it difficult? I mean, I know from Nestor Tan, and he did say that he was trying to run the bank as if it were already QAB qualified. What's getting in the way?
I don't know.
So
maybe they have their they have their own view of what Philippine banks are. I don't know, but it's taking a while.
Banco Central ng Pilipinas' Deputy Governor Nestor Espinilla did say that it's made a lot of the local lenders here more efficient. Would you say so?
Not necessarily. It's because of the demand of the cost of the bank clients. You really have to evolve and become more efficient.